Hey, thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. We have prayed that you'd be blessed by it. We want you to know, too, we believe that this is really supplemental to your experience in the life of a local church. But if you're here in the Dallas area, we hope you'll come and join us and be with us for worship. We pray this blesses your life and you're drawn closer to Christ as a result of this message.
Amen. Hey, it is so great to see you today. I'm so thankful for the opportunity we have to come together. Again, if you're a guest, this is not a normal Sunday for us, but we're so glad that you're here today. We're wrapping up a series of messages we've called Inside Voice, really a sermon series on the doctrine of the Holy Trinity and how the Spirit works in our lives. I started the series talking about a new friend that I have met and made who told me that she experiences this thing called synesthesia. We've talked about this. If you've never heard about this, it's a neurological phenomenon where people actually, there's a lot of different kinds, but they hear music and see color. You know, in a crowd this size, I don't know if any of you has experienced that, but it's crazy. As I've read about this, some of you sent me a Wall Street Journal article just last week about it. People hear music and they see color. Some people see a number or see letters and they start to see color. Hearing certain sounds produces certain tastes in certain people's mouths. How about that? Isn't that crazy? This idea of seeing music, hearing tastes, reading colors, smelling sounds, and even seeing smells. How does that work? It's a completely different dimension, if you will. It's a whole another kind of awareness. It's an acute awareness, I guess, of the senses is how that works. That's synesthesia. We've said it's kind of an apt analogy. In a similar way, when one receives Christ and His grace, when Jesus becomes your forgiver and your leader, your Savior and Lord, He comes into your life. But that's not all that happens. What happens is how this happens, and it's a great mystery. But the Bible tells us when we receive His grace, the Spirit of God comes to live in us. The Holy Spirit is the resident of the Christian's heart. The divine resident in your heart and mind. And it's what unites us. Not simply what we proclaim we believe together, that unites us. But actually His Spirit in us connects us with God and with others in a completely different way. But here's what happens. We've said that the Holy Spirit in us testifies to Jesus in us, but also through us. And we're going to talk about this today because as people encounter us, as they meet us, as they get to know us, as we love them as Jesus has loved us, they experience a kind of synesthesia, if you will. The Bible says that people can see in us the light of Jesus shining through, that we in fact are the fragrance of Christ. They catch this aroma in the workplace because you're there. In your school, students, others see something. They smell something. Can I say it? Spiritually, something's happening because the Spirit works in you to express your love to others. But why is this often not the case? This is what I want to talk about today. I think there's never been a more critical time in the life of our church or in the life of the church in our nation, it seems, in my lifetime, than right now. I don't need to tell you that we have a divided country right now. And what a pastor friend told me recently, some of you will catch this, this is a Bonhoeffer moment for us as believers. To determine that we will follow after the one who is already reigning king and not any political leader. We said this before the election. We're saying it now. When God's people rise up and obey Christ and live countercultural, radical Christian lives, the world takes notice. And not until then. And so today I want to challenge us as we saw this date coming. I wanted to talk today about the unity of the Spirit. Because it starts with unity, not simply in a nation. It begins with us. In our relationships, it begins in the church. The key to all of this is found in the unity of the Spirit. So here's my approach today. We're going to go like a funnel. I'm going to go from a macro level, talk about how we as a church are seeking to be involved in this great challenge that is the challenge in our nation right now. The church can't make a difference. That's my premise. We're the ones who can make a difference. Our politicians have proven that they cannot do so. And our great goal is not just to unite a nation, it's to point people to Jesus. But it happens as God's people are united in Him. We're going to see this is what Jesus taught us. This is a Kairos moment for us. It's an opportune moment as God's people, and I'm convinced that the church is the answer. But it's only going to happen as we turn to the gospel alone, which sets us free from racism, from greed, from entitlement, from violence, unforgiveness, pride. These are not the things of the Spirit. And here's what we've said: a divided nation needs a united church. I want to talk about three events. This is the macro level piece. You can see them on your bulletin here. I want you to be aware of kind of a 90-day horizon critical in life of our church as we move towards Easter. Okay, so with everybody here today, our whole church family, want to say this, that on March 4th, we have coming here, we're going to be hosting Movement Day. This is the most diverse gathering of believers that happens anytime throughout the year in our city. A friend of mine, Bishop Claude Alexander from Charlotte, North Carolina, is going to be here. He has been critical and a key player in this this conversation about race in our nation. And Claude Alexander has said that the fragility of a nation needs the muscularity of a church. The fragility of the nation needs the muscularity of the church to step up and to be the church. Again, listen, our politicians have proven they cannot pull together a divided nation. This is our moment. Abraham Lincoln's the one who said in 1858, when he was running for president, by the way, in a divided nation, he said, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." He's actually quoting a greater liberator than himself. Anybody? Jesus said that. Jesus is the one who led the way. He's the great liberator. He's the one who's calling us to follow Him. And so we're going to have Movement Day here. You can go online and register. I want you to be here. The Gettys, Keith and Kristen Getty, are going to be here to lead worship. We sang a song by Keith Getty earlier in Christ Alone. That night, we're going to have a concert worship experience with them, inviting our whole city to come. We're going to have the pulpit swap on March the 26th. Pastor Carter will be here from Concord Church. I'll be at Concord. Love for you to come. Join me. We have challenged 50 churches, pastors, and groups to come and join us on that day, or I should say across our city, to swap pulpits, and it's happening. Met with a group of pastors this week, and it's exciting what's happening. Transform Dallas is April the 8th. This is where we're going to come together with churches across Dallas to serve. On the 9th, be aware, on Palm Sunday, we're going to have a presentation of the musical Savior as we focus on our reason for hope and unity in the body and to proclaim to the world that Christ is the Savior. And so we're going to have that here combined on Palm Sunday. And then Easter Sunday, the 16th, we're going to all be inviting our friends to come and join us on that day. But I just want to say to our church family, to all of you, way to go, church family. I say all this on a macro level because you are making a difference. We are making a difference. But I can tell you that it all starts with us to be united around Jesus Christ. You know, as I've talked to younger generation, millennials and younger, kind of Gen Z now, nothing frustrates a younger generation more than a church that is not united around what matters most. When a church gets off on non-core issues, and things that really don't matter. And so we're a church that seeks to be united around what matters most. So let's talk about it, the unity of the Spirit. I want you to turn to John chapter 17. Turn to John 17. We've looked at the Upper Room Discourse has been our text for this series of messages, and it ends with Jesus' final prayer. Now you might imagine the final prayer of Jesus that we have here before He goes to the cross. He's about to be arrested and taken to the cross. And so His final prayer is one you'll discover is for unity. It's interesting. It's for you and for me. It's been said, you know, if you want to find yourself in the Bible, you may not have known that you're in there. You're in the Bible and you are here in this passage. So how would you like to be, begs the question, the answer to Jesus' prayer? This is our hope. And it's going to be as we achieve oneness around him and seek him. It trickles down into all areas of your life. So today what I want to do now as I go take this funnel and guide it towards us personally, I want you to think about your own relationships. I want you to think about people in your life. Maybe a tender moment, hard moment. Think about people that you are not, gosh, maybe it's hard for you to love. You know, the people where there's extra grace that's necessary. Maybe that's you. And so today, the Lord's going to speak to all of us about relationships in our home, in the workplace, in our marriage, and he's going to guide us. This message will change your life if you apply the Word of God. So listen to John chapter 17. I'm going to read verses 20 through 26 because it's the very end of his high priestly prayer, we call it. Verse 20. I do not ask for these only. So he's been praying for his disciples. But for those who will believe in me through their word. Now, who's that? Well, that would be us. That would be us. That they may all, everybody say all be one, just as. That's the most powerful word in the text. Everybody say as. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us. Now again, we're seeing this. This is the dizzying doctrine of the Trinity. The Father is in the Son in the Father, the Spirit. Now us in them, we enter into this holy relationship that preexisted before time in eternity. Now we join in. And verse 23, and in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one. And here it is. So that, this is that purpose statement, this is the reason, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know you, that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. Notice he says in verses 22 through 23, the glory. So the glory is the expression of God's character, namely his holiness. Think about this. His holiness, okay, given to me, his righteousness, Jesus is saying, I've given to them. We have now been covered in the righteousness of Christ. It's not our righteousness, but his given to us, imputed righteousness is how the theologians say it, that we may be one together, okay, love each other, united in him, same Christ, same character, same righteousness, so that we'd be perfectly one, so that the world would know that Christ is who he said he was and is, and that now he loves us even as Christ has been loved by the Father. So here's the main point I want you to catch today if you take notes on sermons, and we're going to apply this. Our love for others points others to his love for us. Simply put, right? Our love for others, each other, points others to his love for us, for them, for us all. Our unity points others to Jesus. Why is it then that we so often are not, how about this, others are not experiencing the love of Christ through us? Could it be that we are not united in him first, with him, walking with him, and that our heart's affection is not focused on what matters most? Our mind's attention is not focused on what matters most. He says, if we do this, then we'll be united. Now listen, I want to say this to our guest, if you're thinking, okay, Jeff, it sounds like, is there something behind this? I mean, it sounds like, is there this unity of the Spirit? Is there disunity in the church? Is there, that's my problem in the church, always infighting. Wait, whoa. Now, we are united as a body. We're united under Christ. But here's the thing, if you want to find the perfect church, if you find it, don't join it. You'll ruin it. Okay, don't do it. There's no perfect church because the church is made up. People say, but there's sin in the church. Yes, there's sinful people who make up the church. But listen, there's no perfect church, but there's no other place to be a Christian. There's no other place to grow in Christ, to become like Him. And that's our whole desire, is to glorify Him, for us to challenge and encourage each other to follow Jesus every day. It's an imperfect people seeking to love each other imperfectly. But we're growing. We're pursuing Christ. We're redeemed people. And here you experience the presence of the Holy Spirit in ways you would not otherwise. And I've talked to so many people in recent days who have experienced the love and kindness of our congregation. This past weekend, some of you were part of this unapologetic conference. It was awesome, by the way. Anybody? Anybody there? Lots of you. I know hundreds of our people and others were there. And it was fantastic. But here's the ultimate apologetic. It's us. It's our love for each other. If we would love one another like Christ loves us, we don't have enough seats here to fill this place up. If we would love one another with an eye and an ear and a heart towards the outsider, we couldn't keep people away. And it's happening in pockets and people and in you. I've talked to so many new members, and we've had hundreds of people who've joined our church just since August. And I'm hearing over and over again how they've been loved into this place. So praise be to God. Well, how can we apply this in our relationships first, and how then it goes forth as Jesus has taught us? Well, Paul goes on in Ephesians 4. I want you to turn to Ephesians 4. We're going to read through verses 1 through 6. And I want to bring some application to this sermon, and you're going to have to do that, of course, as the Spirit speaks. I'm going to seek to guide you. But what a joy it is to open the scriptures and to look at how we can apply this and become more and more like Jesus. Now, while you're turning there, everyone, Ephesians 4, Paul's writing from prison in Rome. He's in a pluralistic, hostile culture, and he's writing a letter now to those in Asia Minor who are experiencing a very, secular, irreligious, very religious, I suppose, pluralistic, hostile environment. And he's seeking to encourage these imperfect believers as they seek to love each other. And here's what he says. Here's what's most important. Echoing the words of Jesus, I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, literally and figuratively, he's a slave to Christ, urge you to walk, that is to live, and I'm in the ESV here, in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. Now listen to this. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit. There it is. In the bond of peace, there's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So how do we maintain this unity of the Spirit? Let's talk about it. Let's talk about our common union in Christ, okay? Again, if you take notes, I want to offer what I find here about six things that will help us to maintain the unity of the Spirit. Now, remember that unity is not uniformity. We talk about this often. Uniformity says, you agree with me, we're going to get along really well. Now, this is what is being modeled by leaders that we see often in our world today. But the reason there is discord and disunity that takes place in relationships is because we have forgotten what or who unites us, or perhaps we've never known. So I want you to apply this into your relationships, into your marriage, into your families and friendships. These are core commonalities. This is good for a family, by the way, to declare these are core truths for us. This is how we operate here. If you haven't done that, this might help you a little bit. Okay, first of all, I want you to see there's a common competence, All right. In verse 1, we are all prisoners of the Lord. We belong with Paul. We too are captivated by his grace. We have a common confidence in our Lord Jesus. We proclaimed it and sang about it this morning. It's the confidence of the Spirit in us that cries out, Abba, Father. We know that we are his children because of the Spirit in us. And so we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. We have a unity that is greater than even a natural biological family because of the Spirit in us. And some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you who don't have believers in your family, and it grieves you and it's difficult, and you come together, you can't wait to come and be in God's family because you're so encouraged and blessed by that. If he's Lord of our lives and the Spirit resides in us, then we will love one another as Christ has called us to love. In fact, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, it's even more explicit. John says, if you don't love each other, the Spirit of God is not in you. I mean, it's that clear. It's proof when we love one another that Christ abides in us. If we don't, we won't forgive. We continue in bitterness or struggle in relationship, and we won't take steps and acts of grace towards the other. The Spirit of God is not in us, surely not prompting and leading us. So we have a common confidence in Christ. We belong to him. Secondly, a common character. He gives this list then of four characteristics. Did you catch them? Now you can get a whole list of the fruit of the Spirit, of course, in Galatians 5, 22. But here he mentions four. Let this be a test, this quick word study, okay? A test for you. So the first one is humility. Humility. I'm grateful that this is a word that marks all of our staff who serve you, our ministers. That's the first thing that we look for, because to be humble is to be like Jesus. Now, in the King James, the word was lowliness. We don't word that. We don't use that word a lot anymore. Certainly not in America, right? Who wants to be lowly? I mean, we need to have high self-esteem. You need to think highly of yourself. That's where we are now, right? That's what your problem is. You need to think more highly of yourself. Well, think about this. See, to have a low view of oneself doesn't mean that you're not at the same time beloved of God, that you can be confident in him. And even more, who wants to choose to be lowly in our culture today? You know who? Every believer. Choose to be lowly and humble. Here's what this means. See, the lowly person understands that their knowledge is not that great because they have been captured by the wisdom of God. They've seen it. A humble person is lowly because they recognize that their righteousness is so low, even garbage, because they've been captured by the righteousness of Christ. They've seen it. We're lowly and weak because we've seen the power of God. You see, we're lowly because the Bible tells us that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So a Christian, to have a low view of herself or himself, is to say that I am at the same time, listen, only the gospel does this, I'm at the same time the chief of sinners, and I am fully loved, totally accepted by God. My confidence is in him. And I can love others boldly without any love in return because of his great love for me. That's what it means to be lowly. Well, then he says, gentleness will mark a person. This word is meekness. Another translation, this is power under control. Maybe you've heard this. It's the powerful horse that's been tamed, controlled, and is now able to function and act in a way that it should. It's guided. We are guided by the Spirit. So gentleness has within it this element of grace. And then patience, long-suffering is the word. Again, another word we don't use too often. It's a compound word in the Greek, which is long passion, literally. Long anger. So it means that this person is slow to anger. I want to ask you, would that describe you as a father, as a wife or a mother? Does that describe you? Would your coworkers describe you as slow to anger? that is not quick to respond and react and retaliate. Jesus taught us this. And so, see, it's why Jesus said for us to love our neighbors. Love your neighbor. And when he said love your neighbor, he knew that your neighbor was going to be different than you. He was going to be different from you. He knew that your neighbor was not going to agree with everything that you believe, wasn't going to act exactly like you want him or her to act. Jesus knew that, which is why he said it. It's in the context of the story of the Samaritan, of ethnic and racial tension. Then he was more explicit. If you love people who are just like you, that's everybody does that. The unregenerate heart, and people do that. But to love others who are not like you, that's shocking. That's grace. That's what the world needs to see. See, I've said it this way. Don't let your desire to be right talk you out of being kind and loving. This is a problem in our world today. If we don't love others who aren't like us, that's the law of reciprocity, is what that is. That's not grace. And we're being called to grace and to love others. Then he says another character trait is endurance. This word is forbearance. Forbearing one another. It really means enduring one another. You have anybody in your life where you just like, I just got to endure this person, right? But you do it because we've been called to. Endurance marks the patient person who's he's here telling imperfect people who he knew would be sinful and prayerless and prideful to be loving towards one another. And so he says, we're going to be lowly, we're going to be gentle, we're going to be patient, we're going to be forbearing, remembering the person and work of Christ, who was all of these things for us. So we have a common competence, we have a common character. Look, thirdly, a common conviction. This is verse 3. We're all eager to maintain the unity of, and he says, the bond of peace. Christ is our peace. Now, are you eager to maintain unity in the body? Are you seeking to do so? Are you trying hard to be loving, or do you want to stay divided? You don't want to talk with others who aren't like you. Don't let being right talk you out of being loving and gracious, especially to brothers and sisters in the Lord. And so a result of this then, fourthly, we have a common care for one another. It's the natural overflow. We love each other well with an eye towards outsiders, always, and welcoming in those who are not like us, right? Now, can I say this? I must say this. It's on everybody's mind, and I've got to say it. Listen, we don't need politicians to tell us how to act towards outsiders, towards immigrants, and aliens. Jesus has already told us. I understand the vetting and the need to, you know, for safety and all those things. Nobody is arguing that. But we must embrace people of all kinds as believers. And if you want to get involved in a ministry that's making a difference, we're going to be opening, in fact, a ministry center over in the Vickery area, great concentration of immigrants and aliens, if you will, refugees. And we've been blessing and serving them for some time. And I want to encourage you to get involved. You see, this is where we stand and we say we're going to follow and obey the King. And it's a time for us to be the church in a countercultural way to radically love others. We have opportunity to do that. I praise God for that. We care for one another, but we care for outsiders. Look at number 5. We have a common call. The calling to which you have been called, he says. Christ unites us, and his mission ignites us. We're united around him and his unique mission that he's given to us. And then finally, a common Christ. We see this in verse 5. If you're a guest today, you need to hear this. We are a church united, not around, you know, similar backgrounds, or because we're exactly the same ethnicities, or by politics, or any politician or leader or person or color of our skin, or because we all grew up in this church or even in a Baptist church. We're not united because of our gender We're not united because we all agree on every passage of Scripture in the same way. That's not what unites us. We're not united around music or a certain preference of worship. You know, I know people that would rather be divided or separated from brothers and sisters in the Lord because of their certain preference. And they can't celebrate the entire body of Christ. That's divisive. That's not the Spirit of Christ. That's not unity in the Spirit. And so we prefer one another. We die to ourselves, is what Paul tells us in Philippians 2, considering others more important than ourselves. Christ unites us. Our mission unites us to worship, to connect and serve, and to multiply, to become disciple makers. Friends, listen, our unity is fixed in Christ. We just have to work it out. The reason that we see nation divided against nation, and gosh, I've experienced of late, even spouse divided against spouse, families who are divided. Perhaps you have family members or friends you haven't talked to in years. And the reason is because we're divided in ourselves. We are sinful and we're in need of rescue. Our love for others points others to His love for us. But it all starts with His love. 1 John 4:10 says this, "In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins, the atoning sacrifice for our sins." All that we do and the way that we love others, determined by Christ, determined by His Word, we obey and we love because of His great love for us. He became the wrath satisfier. He became the one who would be our substitute. This is what the world needs to see. They will see, they will smell, they will hear as we love them unconditionally and as they see us love each other in the way that God has called us. It's going to happen in your home, in your work, in your relationships if you live this way. But you've got to take the first step of grace as Christ has done for us. I want to close with this thought. When I was in college, I learned of the story of Jim Elliot. Some of you know Jim Elliot was a missionary to Ecuador, where he was martyred along with some of his friends. They were in their 20s when they were speared to death by the Auca Indians, the very people they had gone to share the gospel with. I was captured by his story and his commitment to Christ as a young college student. And I read in his journal a prayer that became my prayer. And it has been every day of my life, effectively, since then. He wrote this, "Father, make me a crisis man. Bring those I contact to decision. Let me be not a milepost along the road of life. Let me be instead a fork in the road so that others are faced with a decision about Jesus because they've met Him in me." Friends, this is the calling to which we've been called. Our love for others points others to His love for us. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You for this countercultural, radical kind of love that You've called us to. It's hard for us to love in this way. We struggle in our relationships, our friendships. We struggle in our marriages. We struggle with our kids, in our families. We struggle in the boardroom, in the PTA, on the soccer team. We struggle in the marketplace. We struggle to love this way, but You've called us to it. And we know, Lord, that it's going to happen as we die to ourselves and turn to You, our great King. We want to follow You alone in this Kairos moment that we have as a church. It's our Bonhoeffer moment to rise up and to speak the truth with grace and to be the church You've called us to. So may it be the case, Lord. I pray that we turn our eyes to Jesus and our hearts to You above all else, and You alone would guide us This is the kind of church you've called us to be. Thank you, Lord, that we are and are becoming more and more that church. I pray for those who are here who do not yet know you, that they'll receive your grace, understand that you've died for their sin upon the cross, and that you called them to join the fellowship, the family of God. So, Lord, move among us. Continue to draw others to us. Even today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. If you would like more information about our church or following Jesus, please go to our website, pcbc.org, or contact our church offices. We hope to see you next week at church.